Good morning, everyone. I'm here to tell you about the reflection written in an article by myself and my colleague Redina Mazelli. I will start from the title, In Search of Contemporary Yaksha. The Japanese words yaksha, currently mean peasants, come from the union of two ideograms, yaku, which means 100, many, a lot, and sho, surname, rank, traits. Yaksha, lot of traits, originally indicates the man who could do everything, the vernacular man. Using a Guinness and words, a French Japanese architect, Yaksha was the farmer in charge of building and repairing the terraces and his own house, of producing the sustenance goods and transforming them into food through locally sheep or making a profit through selling them. The one that manually built his own tools, passing down knowledge to his children. All these companies guaranteed the subsistence and autonomy of the village. Nowadays, the figure of the farmer has lost in original meaning. Rural area and terraces landscape are suffering from several abandonment and degradation, especially in industrialized countries. These derive mainly from cultural transformation that have replaced subsistence with mechanized production. Now, only land that is accessible by machinery is still cultivated. Terraces are considered low productive and with high labor, and they are not maintained anymore. In addition to this depopulation and aging in rural areas, one of the causes of the interruption in the transmission of dry stone construction techniques, along with the common thinking that the recovery of terraces requires skilled labor and high cost. Nevertheless, rural areas and terraces are increasingly recognized as a resource for local development, and some initiatives try to counteract abandonment trends. The multidisciplinary collaboration between individuals and network allow to resume part of the autonomy that characterized rural area in the past. It creates an updated and extended figure of Yaksha, who locally applies a global thinking and is able to grasp the multifaceted potential of the territory. The Drywalling School of Japan was founded in 2013 by Sanada Junko. This initiative promotes the drywall stone construction technique, favors a change in the collective imaginary and brings stimuli and expertise in local processes. The school is itinerant through Japan, at the request of local groups, municipality and university labs. The participation fees allow a sustainable management system independent from external funding, guaranteeing autonomy and continuity over the time. Since 2013, about 100 courses have been organized. In 2016, Sanada Junko participated in the International Conference on Terraces Landscape held in Padua, that permit her to visit for the first time the village of Gesh and to meet the members of Kanava Association. Kanava Association is a non-profit organization founded in 2001 in a medieval village, aiming the rehabilitation of rural stone architecture through fields work as well as cultural events. They also do exhibition and work on publication to promote knowledge and awareness of the local value of built heritage. Since this encounter, a collaboration between Drywalling School of Japan and the Kanava Association was stabilized. In 2017, in cooperation with the Tokyo Institute of Technology, this two association organized a first drywall construction workshop in Gesh, followed by a second one in 2019. Under the guidance of local expertise Maurizio Cesprini, a total of 21 students participated, led by Professor Sanada Junko, Kane Koreo and Dito Akira. Alongside construction site activity, guide tour to recover terraces landscape were offered to empathize the close relationship between terraces landscape and agriculture, and between masonry and livelihood activities in Ossola Valley. The construction activity enabled students and organizers to gain first-hand experience of similarities and difference between Italian and Japanese dry masonry techniques, and to exchange skills. The common aspect between the two construction methods derived from the adaptation to the stability required to retain the soil unfilled and to water drainage. The first step is the excavation of a slightly inclined trench where big stones are placed to form the footing, allowing to anchor the wall to the ground. In both cases, the stones are placed slightly backward towards slope in order to create a butter on the external face of the wall, increasing the wall's turnover resistance. The space between the wall and the slope is filled gradually with rocks, allowing the water to pass through the wall itself and reducing hydrostatic pressure imposed by the wet soil. Flat coping stones are placed evenly on the top of the course. The main difference between the two techniques are in construction of the course. The technique is directly influenced by the stone available in the site. Stone in the North Piedmont split or eventually occur in pseudo-parallelepiped shapes, therefore allowing parallel horizontal cores. While in Japan, stone used for dry stone wall often have a rounder shape and are laid diagonally. During the 2017 workshop, following the detection of some round shape, a wall portion were rebuilt using the Japanese technique, raising the curiosity and appreciation of the locals. A common feature between the two techniques is the relationship between form and function. The masonry itself is not the purpose, but a means of survival. The aim is to obtain some flat land suitable for cultivation. Building retaining walls was one of the many agricultural work, a popular art requiring effort minimization, sometimes at the expense of mechanical strength and aesthetic beauty. Peasants were able to develop an efficient technique, based on right and necessary labor, quality and quantity. Japanese students were accommodated in ancient stone buildings. These two associations organized for them some visits to better understand the interesting and complex worlds that surround the construction of the terraces. For this reason, they were taken to quarry and to a local processing workshop. Further visits include Ossola stone villages and the impressive prehistoric dry stone wall of the megalithic area of Barchignoli. The students visit a range of local stone heritage, allowing them to appreciate the different historic techniques and the ancient tools, such as communal oven, grapes presser, and water mills used to obtain walnut oil and flour. In their visit, Maurizio retraced the tradition linked to mountain terraces and discussed their abandonment due to change in agricultural practice and cultural values. Students were offered the occasion to visit a sustainable agricultural project keen to slow food approach and the human ecodynamic principle. They use native seeds and organic fertilizers and cultivate highly rentable products such as saffron and berries. Most of the production is sold to local restaurants and residents. An example is Terra Viva, Association of Viganella, a territory where since the industrial boom, terraces have been gradually turning into forest, and stone buildings have been collapsing. In collaboration with local municipality, the association supports the renovation of houses and the restarting of agriculture, among other things to reintroduce the cultivation of rye. Another example is the agricultural school in Crodo, whose strongly practice-oriented teaching method is based on experimental fields and workshop where students produce wine, cheese, beer and honey. The visit also passed in the small enterprise of Garrone family in Oira, that since 1990 relaunched local wine, whose commercial production had been discontinued at the beginning of the 20th century. Health quality wine is now obtained from the home grapes as well as those sold by small farmers. Vineyards are manually processed from pruning to harvest. The experience, the meals prepared with the local ingredients, suggestive dinner and snacks offered by the villagers with seasonal products, offer the students the opportunity to eat food whose origin and production chain are known and visible, an experience far from the urban habits. This allowed them to understand the link between the building of terraces, the traditional agriculture, and the consumers who support it through the demand for local food that test, as one of the students says, like the primitive principle of human work. The Japanese student had the opportunity to understand what it means and how to be a yakusho today, who collaborates to create a modern vernacular society. On one end, the construction activity allows students to toil and perceive their own physical limits, possible for the first time. This creates an awareness of the bodily relationship with the natural environment, in stark contrast with the lifestyle of the megalopoly they came from. But drywally construction is not about masonry, as a student points out. Participants were deeply immersed in a complex and stratified reality, perceiving the delicate connection that warranted its balance. A livelihood based solely on cultivation on Ossola steep land is now almost impossible, and agricultural work is necessary coupled to other jobs. Not only safeguard the traditional method, but also evaluating local reserves and carry on activity with a future and flexible perspective. The effort to restore stone building and terraces are therefore not only aimed at transforming traditional technique and certainly not to demand to re-establish the lifestyle of the past, but bring a new value to houses and fields that is sustainable to the present time. Canova Association and the Drywalling School have shown how in margin areas traditional knowledge in agriculture, building, craftsmanship, or in how you are a part of a community can be a human development asset and a nature charter which allows diversity to thrive. Thank you.